Okay, listeners, welcome to this episode of Shorts. As you know, we have a whole series of these conversations. I have a very special guest with me today, Mr. Satish Pradhan, who's been the group HR head of the Tata Group for many, many years, actually. Significantly, a lot of global experience of working with senior leaders and in very complex sort of situations. Had a lot of, interaction with global leaders across around leadership and change and what I would call board management, etc. So Satish, welcome very much into this.
Thank you. Pleasure to be here, Vimal.
Okay. So listeners, we are going to have a chat with Satish about top leadership and, his perspectives on how it is sort of evolving. So Satish, launching straight in, how are you seeing the issues around top leadership in a sort of broad sense around the world, firstly?
See, one of the things that increasingly is becoming very palpable to me is this whole question of globalization and global, the word global as we used to use it.
Correct.
If nothing else, I think it's undergoing tremendous change.
Mm-hmm.
I don't ideologically subscribe to, ideological views of The Economist or other people, but The Economist had featured in the middle of last year's summer a book called The Levelers,
mm-hmm.
Which actually, sort of sang the obituary of globalization,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Saying that, globalization is dead and long live the new whatever.
Right.
And the question was, what is this new whatever and why is globalization? Mm. So I think there is a context there,
right,
which is implied in what you're asking.
Correct.
And I will say, only flagging three items. Mm-hmm. One, that business as usual, the world continues to globalize the way we've known it, the way you saw it in Nokia, the way you saw it in your other experiences of various kinds, including current consulting work also. And maybe a little tweaking here and there.
Mm-hmm.
The second is a option of fragmentation.
Right.
So the opposite is, everyone bunkers down.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone becomes, not in a bad way, but in a way, Atmanirbhar.
Correct.
The implication of which is that there is less to do with others.
Correct.
Transacting with others. And
right.
So you... Or the third is a different model of a multipolar world. Now, which may slowly begin to emerge, and before, it's like the boiling frog.
Right.
We may find ourselves that it has happened.
Correct.
And if that were to be the path, then I think there are three key things that we must think about,
mm-hmm.
as we see the future, whatever direction it may go in. One is that there is a clear element of a geopolitical sense, geopolitical, mm-hmm. economic sense, which an astuteness which will be an essential prerequisite,
right,
for anyone who is entering the global economic arena, either as a corporate leader or as any player in that field.
In that field, yeah.
So it becomes a kind of table stakes.
Correct. Correct.
It's an entry ticket, and it will become a very significant one, perhaps quite different from the way it is today. So, mm-hmm. that's one, mm-hmm. flag.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I'm still on the context.
Yeah.
The second part of it is therefore, if we look at what we said were essentials of global leadership as buckets. Mm-hmm. See, specifics, yeah, yeah. You are better positioned to craft out, saying, this orientation towards this or a strategic capacity to think, and defining those is a matter of detailing it. But the buckets, mm-hmm. I think the buckets, which we will still continue to some extent to be the way we thought about it, maybe, mm-hmm. it'll emerge how it'll be different. But for example, at the core of it all will be a certain set of predispositions and deeper origin attributes, let's say, mm-hmm. traits, beliefs, pravritti, move in making sense,
right,
in processing and in responding to any kind of external context that you come up with.
Right, right.
That I think will pretty much remain, but elements will change and I'll talk about it.
Right.
If you then look at what, I mean, you know, why do we look for an MBA in a course? Why do we look for a certain kind of education background, a certain kind of business background?
Ki bhai
padha likha hai, kuch kaam waam kiya hai, acha. Haan, wo, you know, Bimal ke saath kaam kiya hai, Nokia mein kaam kiya hai. So what has he gained by that? He has gained an opportunity to learn and demonstrate and internalize what I would call threshold characteristics or threshold capabilities.
Right.
Or competencies.
Right.
Ki bhai teamwork kya hai?
Hmm.
You know, orientation towards outcomes, result orientation.
Correct.
You know, interpersonal effectiveness with people. These are you know, entry ticket items in one way. Right. So they're threshold. Does he come through that with that? So that is, I think, but it can't, just because it's threshold, it can't be not available because something else is available.
Can't be ignored. Can't be ignored.
Necessary but not sufficient conditions.
Correct. So Satish, before you go forward, let me just, you know, roll back for a minute. And, you know, so the three buckets you're talking about, if I were to just, you know, summarize them for our listeners, I think there is like an entry ticket bucket, which is, as you said, necessary but not sufficient characteristics or conditions for leadership. The second one, which you started with, was really around this whole astuteness of how you see the world kind of a thing.
What distinguishes?
And the third one is this piece, which I really like about this pravritti, that how do you really make sense and therefore respond and react to things around you? And I think it'll be nice. I don't know what else you were going to say, but certainly on this astuteness and pravritti, I think it'll be good, nice to go a little bit deeper into both of those.
Yeah. So let me also flag one more dimension. I don't know how to fit it in, but you have seen this, you have experienced it in your career also.
Right.
There are times when core capabilities, domain or functional,
right,
become a very important ingredient
in
the ability to lead effectively, whether at a global canvas or at a regional canvas or at a national canvas.
Right.
And I want to just flag that as a content piece, which people will have to acquire as they
acquire any which way.
Coming back to the notion of distinguishing, I'll just put two or three points on that.
Yeah.
The ability to, at threshold level, you talk about teamwork. You talk about interpersonal effectiveness, even networks, building networks.
Right.
But the level at which we are talking in distinguishing in this context is like a characteristic to build a network of alliances, a network of institutional collaborations, a network of B2B. You're taking from individual to individual to a level of many to many, individual to institutions, institutions to institutions, and institutions to individuals.
Right.
And that, why am I making a meal out of it? The ability to work in a multipolar world.
Right.
Or in a world in which globalization and the rules of globalization that we've come to adopt, World Trade Organization, rules of engagement, transaction management, it all, you know, is up for grabs. Some of these pieces will need to be held together in the way that you have learned in your past to do business in and with China.
Right, right.
Very different from the rest of the world. Yeah. So it is not a kind of multilateralism where everybody comes together and does it.
Correct.
But it is a multipolar. In this context, this is how I may have to approach it. In that context, this is how I may have to. So now if this, as you, if you put as a fundamental perspective of how you rejig your threshold competence, your core domain stuff, you know, all of that. And then the energy that comes from your pravritti. So having said that about distinguishing, let's move to pravritti.
Right.
Pravritti, I think, is best summed up with a example from our scriptures and the story of Duryodhan. When Duryodhan is asked ki Vimal yaar tum ye why do you do all this stuff,
right.
All this nonsense, why do you do? Bad, you know, why do you do it? So he said, janami dharmam. I know what is right.
Right.
Nacha me pravritti. But I'm not inclined towards that.
Correct.
Jana me adharmam.
So
I know what is wrong also.
Correct.
Nacha me nivrutti. I cannot liberate myself from it.
Myself from it. Correct.
Now, this mirror, one will have to enhance the ways in which one actually becomes more self-aware. So self-awareness was there earlier.
Correct.
It takes on a different tonality.
Right.
Collaboration was there earlier. It takes on a different tonality.
Correct.
Yeah. So this is the way I see things shifting in a manner that is actually quite fast.
Correct.
But is also so imperceptible that we might not even realize it.
Realize that it's shifting. So the boiling frog syndrome, as you called
correct,
it.
Correct.
So Satish, let me therefore, you know, dive a little bit deeper into your Duryodhan example, because I think it's a great example. So are you also saying, or at least in a broader sense, that leaders would be well advised therefore to almost say that if I am self-aware, then I should, or all, you know, the word should is a very deterministic word, but I should make a choice of the context in which I operate, because that is where my leadership capabilities and my leadership perspective will perhaps be most effective. If I know myself, then I know which game I should, you know, play more of, kind of a thing. Therefore, is there a case for leaders making choices of that kind? That is, in which context to operate?
Bimal, I'm glad I'm not in a place where I have to play that kind of a role. But I would be honest in terms of saying that in my thinking, global leaders will not have that as an option.
Right.
The only choices that they will be able to give themselves is how do they play in this multipolar world.
Right.
Not succeeding is not an option.
Not an option, correct.
The option is how, given me, given my beliefs, given my pravritti, given my capabilities, given what I'm committed to, the purpose that I'm committed to the institution that I represent. So purpose-driven leadership and what it means in choice making. Because a lot of the spin that we have been able to put on things may not be so easily available to us.
Right. Yeah.
And so you to answer your question, I don't think that the world will give leaders a choice to say, I'm walking away from being. Yeah, businesses can walk away from a polar, multipolar world.
Correct.
That, you know, in this kind of economic arrangements of this kind, I will not have.
Right.
But, you know, it's like saying I will not participate in a certain consumer market.
Correct.
And I'm selling consumer goods. So,
correct.
You know, the affordability of that kind of choice will be, here again, the question will come. And we've seen a lot in a different way. The temptation is we may think the future will be a repetition of that past.
Also, correct.
Our ability in the past to have partners and intermediaries to sell into areas where, as far as we were concerned, we got an end-use certificate.
Correct. Right.
But we also knew that the end-use was happening somewhere else.
Somewhere else.
Some people slept uncomfortably with those decisions. Some people did not have any difficulty.
Correct.
And some people chose to sleep comfortably by not making that decision or saying, I won't go there. So I don't think that that is going to change. But the premium on what do you genuinely believe in,
correct,
and what do you genuinely try to live by? That, you know, there's not going to be much place to hide
that. Yeah. Okay.
So my guess is that yes, people will still need spin doctors, but spin doctoring will be a very superficial game as we go forward, unless one of the three polarities that I'm talking about starts beginning to evolve into how do you monetize and maximize the untruth or the truth that you want to project? And can you really manage the world in that way?
Right. Yeah. That's an interesting way of putting it, actually.
So, you know, it's a question of what can you sleep with and what do you tell yourself and what do you bring yourself? So come back to the perspective.
Correct.
The core is necessary knowledge, easy to focus on, make sure you get.
Yeah.
The threshold, we've been there. We know that, how to build it, how to give exposure, nurture it, groom it, mentor it, done. The distinguishing and the pravritti are interlinked.
Right.
And the ability to deal with pravritti, I think, is something which is going to challenge humanity as a whole.
But Satish, you know, if I just build on that as a, you know, and that, like you said, there's a link between, you know, the distinguishing and the pravritti. I think one of the elements which we are increasingly seeing, and, you know, you use the word purpose or purposeful, you know, this will then call for, as I see it at least, is a much deeper level of awareness at an individual level of leadership, number one. Number two, a lot of courage, therefore, to be able to act in a bipolar world and say that this is who I want to be and this is how I want to make an impact in spite of the organizational boundaries and the limitations and this thing, because while those boundaries are there, it also opens up a lot more opportunities for leaders to actually create, you know, things around their purpose, if you will. You know, how do you see that?
Brilliant point, Bimal. As always, it's a pleasure to have a conversation with you.
Thank you.
I think the point you make is taking leading with purpose, as I said, where purpose is a given, bestowed on you by institution, shareholders, or others' expectations, to leading the purpose and the formulation of what a purpose is.
Right.
So you then are elevating to the level, do you have what it takes to be able to state what a renewed, refreshed, relevant purpose now needs to be for an institution of this kind. And that again, to go back to what you said, higher level of self-awareness, higher level of contextual awareness, higher level of sense making, and deeper thought into the future.
Right.
So I think it will heighten those. In putting it in work level terms, right, I think you're going to need to be work level 7 before you've finished with work level 3.
Correct. Oh, that's interesting.
Exaggerating to make the point.
I get it. Yeah.
But I think, you know, so that I think is the kind of, it's like saying in simple terms, you're asking a child to go from infant to adult,
correct,
skipping childhood and adolescence and early adulthood.
Yeah. That's a big ask, actually.
That's a very big ask. And therefore, one of the concomitants of that is to dispense with the expectation that we will be fully ready for the kind of challenges that we are stepping up to.
Right.
So I will have had my coaching camps. I will have had first class cricket. I will have done practice sessions with Bimal, whacked him over the boundary, done all that, and be fully ready to play test cricket. Never be fully ready to play
test cricket.
Leadership of this kind.
Correct.
And therefore, adaptive learning. Now, adaptive learning in all these dimensions.
Correct.
Adaptive learning in terms of recognizing pravritti and can you do anything about pravritti?
About it, yeah.
Or are you a Duryodhan?
Correct.
You know, condemned to your pravrittis.
No, that's
we have to learn that. Yeah. You have to learn that. Is it possible? How is it possible? If it is, what else can I do with it?
Correct.
My core. Can I change my core? A lot of people are struggling with the fact that, look, I grew up in a technology business where my core was in the old Nokia days. Correct. And correct. Today, these guys are talking about Python and, you know,
very different world,
cloud. Yeah. And world. What am I mean, how, what am I supposed to, how do I get to this core now?
Correct.
Yeah, digitized clouds, data lakes, artificial intelligence, correct. Algorithm. And the third is the distinguishing. What makes the difference between someone who can succeed in this newly emerging froth?
Right.
When they themselves are not crystallized and correct. Fully ready,
correct.
But are part of the evolving environment.
Absolutely.
It is both a great opportunity and a great challenge.
Correct. Absolutely. Absolutely. So Satish, as we come towards the last part of this conversation, I want to, you know, ask you about two very specific items, and I hope that you'll have a view on it. I'm sure you will. So, you know, one of the things which I've been sort of studying and trying to figure out, and, you know, I'll mention both of them together and then you can have your take. You know, balance, personal balance and judgment. And, you know, given that it's a world which is very, you know, it's almost like there's an earthquake or a volcano under your feet and you're expected to walk, you know, over it as a leader all the time kind of a thing, because you don't know what's coming from where. And increasingly this element of, you know, personal balance where you are dealing with, you know, you use the word multi, you know, bipolar. I'm using the word multipolar and you don't know.
Actually, multipolar. What I said was multipolar.
Correct.
Because the example of that quickly is geopolitical entities like the US, Europe, possibly India, certainly China, maybe some other economically, geopolitically, strategically, militarily, correct. And resource-wise and ingenuity-wise, strong polar ends who can hold their own.
Correct.
That's the multipolar model. That has. Yeah. Sorry, go ahead.
So it will also happen in business where, you know, there's exactly. different segments of consumers, different exactly. segments of other stakeholders, exactly. all that, right? And so personal balance. And the second is, how do you apply judgment in this space? Because, you know, judgment has always been a big one, you know, where, you know, of course, in Indian mythology, we often use the word wisdom rather than judgment. But, you know, what's your take on those two? Because I believe that those two are, along with courage, are actually perhaps going to be the cornerstone of, you know, that differentiation between, you know, somebody who's very good and somebody who can really make a difference, you know, at level 7 in work levels, if you want to call it that. Yeah.
Yeah. I think, first of all, the way you frame the question itself puts an interesting, reflective canvas in front of us. But I think there has never been and there will never be a substitute for the capacity for judgment.
Right.
And the more complexity you are able to engage with and make sense of, the level of decision making and judgment that you will exercise.
Correct.
In both distinguishing as well as in choosing ways and options to engage is going to be all of this that we talked about.
Right.
Ultimately, the razor's edge is the horns of a decision.
Correct. Correct.
Absolutely. So the acid test will be the quality of judgment we are able to bring to bear on what work we are doing.
Correct. Absolutely.
And it will range from elements of very simple, demonstrated by you just now. You made a judgment call in framing an issue in a particular way.
Correct.
You weren't even aware when you did it, but
yes,
that is an exercise of judgment in the very sense making of the issue. And now we are grappling with the sense of judgment in the exercise of a course of action option.
Correct.
So what do we do with it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So at all these levels, the perspective of the width of managing and engaging complexity
right.
Is going to be seminal and will go all the way up to the choices that we are able to even conceive of. Correct. The very framing of the data and the issue will lead to the judgment on the choices.
Right. No, that's a great point you make, Satish. Okay, so Satish, we come to the end of this particular conversation. You know, this is a topic which is very close to my heart, and I do know that it's very close to your heart. So I'm sure we will pick this up for a much, much longer conversation in due course of time. But thank you very much for, you know, being part of this conversation. And I'm sure our listeners will really find, you know, both value in it and love this conversation. So again, thank you very much.
Thank you. Take care. God bless, and all the best to your audiences.
Thank you, Satish.